I'm Dr. Louise Montello. I'm the coordinator of the Creative Arts Therapy Certificate Program here at the new school. And I'm very, very pleased that you've come to join us for our Voice of Freedom performance this afternoon. I'll tell you a little bit about our class. This is actually performances of community-based arts projects that our students have created with members of the community to address and solve social problems. And so you'll be seeing a theater piece, a dance piece, a vocal improvisation piece, and there'll also be room and time for you to interact with our students and community members and also to share your thoughts and feelings about what we'll be seeing today. This class, Transforming Community Through the Arts, actually came out of a collaboration with several faculty members across the university and students who were very interested in arts and social change. And we worked together for a whole semester developing a foundational course that would provide our students with the tools necessary to be able to go out into the community and to work with community members in creating the kind of world that we want to live in. So I'm sure all of you can relate to that idea that Gandhi held so dear to his heart, that we can be the change, and particularly through the arts. It gives us a very strong entree into the hearts and souls of people in the community. So before we get started with our first piece, I would like to thank some of the people that have made this class and these performances possible. Firstly, David Scobie, who is the Dean of the New School for Public Engagement, who allowed us to win a grant to do this research and to create the course. And also the faculty members who have supervised some of these student projects, Randy Mulder, Nancy Koprak, Janet Lawson, and we also have a special guest from the UN, Randy Rydell, who will be speaking to us about the arts and disarmament. And it couldn't come at a better time, having suffered the incredible tragedy from yesterday and ways of using the arts to help the children and families will certainly be very, very important over the next few weeks and months. I'd also like to thank some of our community partners, Caitlin Kaisel and Ulana Tatanchuk from Polaris, a human trafficking organization in Newark. And let's see if there's anybody else I forgot. I guess that's it.
Thank you, Louise.
my pleasure. It's great to be here. So, our first performance is called Unmasking Our Past, Claiming Our Future. The process of creating this piece began in the middle of September. Participants from the New School's Transforming Community Through the Arts class and the Polaris Project, an organization dedicated to combating human trafficking and modern-day slavery, created a collaboration to discover ways in which they could use art to transform themselves and their community. Over these past few months, and under the supervision of a drama therapy faculty member, they met on a weekly basis using theater as their vehicle for this exploration. Each session began and ended with a ritual, a time to check in with one another or share how they experienced the group before departing. New theater exercises and activities were introduced weekly. They pretended to be other people or played themselves. They danced, they drew, they laughed, and they cried. Their hesitations and fears about sharing their lives started to fade away. Over time, they formed their own community, a community of respect, of inspiration, strength, and empowerment. This performance represents a part of this process. Keep in mind that most of the performers are not trained actors and may have never been on a public stage. Positive feedback and encouragement, of course, is much appreciated. We hope that you will enjoy this performance. Thank you.
Time. Everlasting movement. Incessant ticking. Can't stop time, let's chase it. Since we can't erase it, let's bury our broken hearts in sun-washed deserts. Let's come alive again. If only I could wash the stains of misery off your faces. I hear you, I am you. Sorrow poisons your bones, you cannot move. But a woman as beautiful as you is supposed to be dancing and praying and singing and living. But a woman like you don't know how to talk to God, or find the beauty in a sunset, or even part your lips to let laughter erupt from your bellies. I know you, women like you, like us, gave birth to tragedies, bloodshot eyes, hearts rotting. Life has hijacked smiles, your tongue craves death because it's so sweet. We hang out at clubs and dim-lit bars, speakers throbbing, music swallows your tears. You try to find yourself, but ain't no GPS system that could lead you back to you. I am one of you. I breathe the same sad air you do. But instead of dying, I write to put bandages on wounds that never seem to heal, in hopes that words could resurrect your corpse. And maybe this poetry could reincarnate you, and yesterday would have meant nothing. One day, you will stare back in the mirror and realize how exquisite you are. You got rose petal lips and rubies for eyes. I know those mornings you sit stiff, not wanting to rise, and the nights you sit contemplating goodbyes. I know you miss the days when you were alive, before you ever knew what hell felt like, before you scribbled suicide notes on the backs of grocery lists. Remember what alive felt like? Don't let it kill you. Don't let it. Because we got wars to fight and minds to ignite. Rise up from your ashes and let us unite. We search star-drenched nights trying to find God's smile. Our souls need redemption, but the voids go unfilled. So I will lead you to a place where freedom awaits, and we can dance and pray and sing and live the way that we were meant to.
One thing you don't know about me is that I love to play soccer. One thing you don't know about me, I love to go shopping for sale items and clearance items.
One thing you don't know about me is I climb Kilimanjaro.
One thing you don't know about me is my favorite food is cupcakes.
One thing you don't know about me, I love bunnies.
One thing you don't know about me is that I never graduated high school.
One thing you don't know about me is my favorite color is red.
One thing you don't know about me is I love to sing in the shower.
There ain't no flies on us. There ain't no flies on us. There may be flies on some of you guys, but there ain't no flies on us.
There ain't no flies on us. There ain't no flies on us. There may be flies on some of you guys, but there ain't no flies on us.
There ain't no flies on us.
There ain't no flies on us. There may be flies on some of you guys, but there ain't no flies on us.
There ain't no flies on us. There ain't no flies on us. There may be flies on some of you guys, but there ain't no flies on us.
It can be hard living in the busiest city in the world, trying to pursue your dreams, but feeling like you're just coasting, not really advancing to where you want to go. Working a full-time job with long hours and rude customers. Trying to maintain friendships, while these so-called friends are constantly complaining that you're too busy and you're always blowing them off. Trying to balance these things that are inevitable and apparent, along with all the other things that you just can't seem to get a grip on, is enough to make you want to crawl into a hole and never come out. You become jaded, angry, and careless. So desperately you're searching to find your purpose, find your strength, find something to bring the light back into your life when it seems so dark. I would have never imagined that by working with human traffic survivors, the sun in my light would begin to shine again. That this would be the true test of how strong I really am by witnessing the strength of others around me. Upon meeting the women at Polaris, I would have never known that they faced such trauma. They carry themselves with such fearlessness, tenacity, and strength. They've inspired me because they're working to overcome the hardships that they once faced by creating better lives for themselves now. They've showed me that no matter how bad things are, they can always get better. We all must die a bit before we grow again. And in these months, I've grown tremendously. I've watched my classmates who I never knew before working on this project and now consider to be a group of my best friends grow as well. And I've watched these women that we've been given the opportunity and been blessed to work with grow. Together, we've all blossomed. My life has changed. My heart has changed.
Habits and defense mechanisms I created to cope. But now I'm not really sure I want to take the time to rewire myself. I want to heal with all my might. But am I really ready?
One thing when you read statistics, numbers on a page. It's awful. It's terrible. It's unbelievable. But you're removed. You're free to detach and put this information in the corner of your brain. But when you get to know these people, become friends with these people, you're not removed anymore. It's not as if you're watching a film on the topic or reading an article. These people have become your friends. They like the same music as you. They like the same flavor of ice cream. They love to dance. They love to chat. They joke around. They have bad hair days. They get tired. They get stressed. They make faces. They love to laugh. And yet, this has happened to them. Someone has done this to them. These people who you look so forward to seeing, who you have worked so hard with, someone has done this to them. And you get so sad and so angry, so mad. You hate the people that did this to them. You can't understand how anyone could break someone so beautiful, so wonderful, so talented, and so full of life. It's not right. It's not right. It's hard to hold. And then you realize, if it's this hard for me to hear, what must it have been like to go through? You realize how strong these people, your friends, are. They are survivors. They have overcome. And around them, you feel empowered. Around them, you feel inspired. With them, you feel the strength of what you are all doing together. You know how special these friendships are. You are proud. You are honored. You are happy to be a part of something so great.
There's a little girl inside me. I've told her not to cry. I told her to stay quiet, and soon it'll all be over. She's weak and needy. This world would eat her alive, always kicking and screaming. Look at what's been done to me. See me, hear me, feel me. She's been trapped inside so long. Waiting, sometimes fighting to come out. She's out of control and it embarrasses me. A long time ago, I abandoned her in order to move forward and survive. I've left her. Why won't she leave me? She is me. I hate her. But I must love her. So I drink to calm her nerves. I pop pills to make her sleep. But she's relentless and acts out. She cuts me to make me feel the pain. Her pain is too strong. Go away, I tell her. But it just fuels the fire and we go out and destroy each other.
A few months ago, I discovered I was two people. The other secret person was a little four-year-old girl who stopped growing up when my father left. I remember seeing my two brothers and me watching my father walk down the street, and he never looked back. I stopped eating, and my mother panicked, and so she tied my wrists and held my nose. And then when I gasped for air, she forced food down my throat. What she didn't know is that caused an eating disorder and a tremendous fear of being trapped. When my mother divorced, she sent me to my aunt, and she gave me so much love. I didn't want to go home, but I had to go home, and I pretended not to be hurt when nothing I ever did was good enough for her. 3 years later, when I was 7, I wanted to sing like my mother, who was an opera singer. So she gave me a test, and she said, "Well, dear, why don't you study the piano?" I yearned for my mother's love, but I never got it. So I finally ran away to New York City, and I did well professionally, but emotionally, I was blocked. I was always looking for something that was missing. When I discovered that this little girl was a part of me, I wanted to kill her off. She was stubborn, she was capricious, so I started to ignore her like my mother ignored me. But now, she is a part of me, and I want to listen to her story, and I'll tell her mine. I'll be the mother, and she can be the little girl I never had. So I think someday I will teach her to sing.
Your face, ran fingers through your hair, and told you, "It's okay, girl. We're okay. Don't be afraid. You're not alone. I see you. I hear you. I'm with you. And I will never leave you." Off my mind. I think about you all the time. Tell me what happened. I'm ready to know. Speak up, little girl. I'm listening. It's safe to say, safe to cry, safe to scream out all your fears. Because I will protect you forever. I love you. I want you. I am you, and I am not ashamed. I love you, and you are beautiful.
Is this the illest shit I ever wrote? It's probably not, but it's the realest I ever spoke. They call me a cocky chick, say I'm real cutthroat. So I'ma feed this to you until you choke. I'ma pump it in your veins like it's critical. It's so illicit, but you need to know. I've been called everything from a bitch to a hoe. Let me take it back to some years ago. I would have hung myself if you gave me the rope. When I think about it, it gives me the chills. Age 13 with a handful of pills, telling my mom I don't want to live. She laughs, then she yells, "Do it!" Emotionally intoxicated. All these words I'm saying never fabricated. My story is not beautiful. Every day I'm waking hoping it's my time to go. This place looks familiar. Have I been here before? It's like failure just sits and waits at my door. Pretty girl with the ugliest thoughts. All these voices are loud. Someone please turn them off. I've been trying to find myself my whole life. I guess I'm permanently lost. And everywhere I turn, they putting labels on me, but I can't even bother being affected. Their words ignite the hunger within me. Like a blind man, I'm dying to see a brighter tomorrow, but today is just like yesterday. All I see is sorrow. I'm trying to find another life I can borrow, because the one I'm living, man, this shit's dark. And I don't want sympathy, just give me a new start. I'm coming unraveled, I'm falling apart. Why can't nobody see my heart? I got a grandma who was more like my mama. Way less critical and never came with the drama. It's like when she left, I left with her. My mind spins thoughts like a blender. Sex, lies, betrayal, rape, and scandal. Trying to find a resolution, trying to get a handle. Have you ever been broke, penniless, hopeless? Everything you own just gone, now you homeless? Mentally, you never sleep. Awaken your mind so you never dream. You open your eyes to reality. Tears break down your face and now it's hard to breathe. Mama don't love me. Daddy don't know me. I'm just a walking tragedy. But forget all that, woe is me. I am who I am. I accept it. I embrace it. I write this down so you never forget it. So my daughters can read this and say that they get it. I was gonna throw in the towel, man. I was ready to end it until the day I realized I could not quit. I never felt happiness until the day I had kids, and now they wanna take the best thing that ever happened to me. Keep on saying, just let it be. Like they don't even matter to me. Man, I'm gonna go off. It's gonna get ugly. But if you ain't feeling me, I'm gonna put this in a song and let you put it on repeat. See, no one knew what it was like. The moment the truth dropped, kicked me in the face, I choked on my own heartbeat. Laying awake, my eyes wide open, I suspect the abrupt sting of razor blades dancing on my throat would be more bearable than this. How must I go on? They took the only thing that mattered me. Those cowardly thieves. They took my little girls from me. I want to paint the walls crimson with my agony. How must I go on? How far will I go to prove my love? Oh, I will go far. My mind has left my body. Thoughts hold no rationality. Oh, I will go far. I am a fighter and I will fight. Night after night, I count the seconds. I could not await till the bodies tucked within my arms. I cannot tattoo kisses on their foreheads and cheeks to remind them of my relentless affection. No one knew what it was like. No longer comforted by the sound of their voices, their innocence filling my ears with joy. I was left with the echoes and memories of laughter and triumph. I was sometimes slipping away. My feeble heart got the best of me in ways you could not understand. Alone with my memories running wild through my mind like fires. If I would have ended it there on the bathroom floor, my back hugging the corner, what would they think of me? They would not say Mom was an audacious one and she fought until her arms collapsed at her side. No, they would say I gave an okay fight, but my defeat was premature. Didn't allow my name to saturate the lips of my superiors. I died without a legacy. Besides, how could I be so selfish? Leave behind the only ones I still breathe for to this despicable world? I could not, so I peeled myself out of bed day after day, although they had snatched all my pain away from me. As long as my heart still tiptoed inside me, I would fight for them relentlessly, 998 days and counting. They took the only thing that mattered to me, but I will fight for you. I will fight. Thoughts so redundant, constant replay of my firstborn, the first day I ever laid eyes on her. A face so exquisite, a smile so radiant it could provoke tears. I remember everything until I remember nothing. And so many days I sit waiting, waiting apprehensively. And then it becomes an illusion. Seconds feel like hours and hours feel like years. Years, decades since I've been intoxicated by the beauty of my daughters. Trying to be the best, leave no traces of my mother. Replaying conversations, laughter, night becomes day and I lay awake. Although they have left me here to perish, urge me to go on without them. I promise, as long as the sun still rises, as long as my mind still churns these memories, and as long as my eyes still ignite at the sight of their faces and pictures, I will fight for them. Yeah.
Why am I doing this to to myself, losing my mind on a tiny error. I nearly left the real me on the shelf. To do to fit the mold, yeah. The more I try, the less it's working.
To be no other words. Thank you, Polaris Group. That was amazing. So we're going to move right along with something that is going to go deeper into improvisation as a way of transforming and empowering people in the community and in our school. And the piece is actually called Emotional Symphony. As if you're not emotional already, we're going to have a little bit more flavor happening here. So let's welcome the Emotional Symphony, led by Janet Lawson.
Thank you, Louise. That was extraordinary, truly. This next part, called An Emotional Symphony, is going to deal with transforming expressions of social violence through improvisation. As an improvisational jazz singer, I feel that expression of what we are, who we are, our spontaneous nature, taps in to what is possible, the potential, the full, rich, limitless potential within all of us. And so we're going to explore racism and discrimination, bullying and competition, greed and power, the rights and evolution of women, and through the divine spark of consciousness, which will include some improvisation, arrive at awareness and compassion, cooperation, generosity, acknowledgement, and love of self and others. And this whole piece is totally improvised. I mean, we've rehearsed and we've connected with different themes, but I don't know what they're going to do. They don't know what they're going to do. It's just going to be in the moment. So what we need from you are a negative emotion. Could you give us a negative emotion? Hate. Thank you.
Hate.
And a positive emotion.
Gladness.
Pardon?
Gladness.
Oh, that's beautiful. Hate and gladness. The first movement is racism and discrimination.
You don't belong here.
Get out of here. Just go home. Just go home. Get out of here. Just go home.
Not your kind. Not your kind.
Just go.
You don't belong here. You don't belong here.
Just go home.
There is a vacancy in my company. This is the qualification. This is the qualification. This auto is the qualification.
Sold.
This is only for our kind.
Bullying and competition.
You're a loser. You're a loser. You're a loser. Loser, 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 loser.
Get out of my way. Get out of my way. Get out of my way.
Oh, yeah?
Get out of my way.
Oh, yeah?
Get out of my way.
Oh,
get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Come here.
Get out of my way.
Come here.
Get out of my way.
Come here. Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
Oh yeah? Come here.
Get out of my way.
knock you out.
Me first.
Mama said knock you out.
First.
Get out of my way. 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 Get out of my way.
This is your size? Oh, God. This is your size? This is your size. This is your size? Wow.
I'll get there. Greed, greed, and power.
Money, 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 must be funny. Money, 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 must be funny. Money, 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 must be funny. Money, money, money.
Over there, not here. It's the power that I want. I want the power.
Money, money, money.
Go around the world. Go around the world.
Go around the world. Go around the world. Go around
the world. Is mine. The world is mine. The world is mine. The world is mine. It's all mine. It's all mine. It's all mine. The world is 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 mine.
I need an Xbox. I need an iPhone. I need a laptop. I need the latest technology. I need everything, everything, everything you got. Give it to me, give it to me, give it to me.
Give me, give me, give me.
I need an Xbox, iPhone. I need the latest digital technology. I need a speaker, phone, a computer, a laptop, television.
The rights and evolution of women. From a man's point of view. The divine spark of consciousness.
There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, if truth is what you see. There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, if truth is what you see.
You can do anything.
There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, if truth is what you see. There's another side to see,
to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, if truth is what you see. There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, if truth is what you see. There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, truth is what you see. There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, if truth is what you see. There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, if truth is what you see. There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, if truth is what you see. There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, the truth is what you see. There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, the truth is what you see. There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key, if truth is what you see. There's another side to see, to understand reality. Multiple perspectives key.
Great.
Special thanks to Redeema for the wonderful, wonderful singing, along with all the other great voices. So, how y'all doing?
Great.
All right, we're going to take a little break, a 10-minute break, just to mingle a little bit and clear your palate for a dance performance in 10 minutes. So we'll see you back then. Thank you. Just to let you know that we have a reception following the show at the Lang Cafe, which is through the courtyard on the other side of the building. So we're hoping that you can join us. And if you have any questions about the Creative Arts Therapy Program here at the New School or any other kinds of questions on the arts and social engagement, we'll all be hanging out and happy to answer any of your questions or even hear your suggestions. So we are very, very pleased to welcome our next guest speaker, Randy Rydell, who is working at the UN in the Office of Disarmament. And he is also a musician. He's a trumpeter with the UN Symphony, newly formed symphony. And he's going to talk to us about how the UN uses the arts in helping to create peace in the world. So let's welcome Randy Rydell. Thank you.
Not going to sing today. Frankly, there are too many singing drunk Santa Clauses outside, I think. I want to thank Louise, Dr. Montello, for inviting me, and it really is a privilege and an honor for me to be with you today. I had mixed feelings preparing my talk today in light of recent events that we've all been saddened to see from Connecticut. My feelings are quite troubled by the tragedy. I was also in Virginia when the Virginia Tech incident happened. And I also have memories of the Columbine incident, and one after another, these come back to haunt me. But in a strange kind of way, they also help to reassure me of the importance of the work we're trying to do in the field of disarmament and peace and security at the UN, and I'd like to talk about that today. It's also been moving for me because last week I was in Nagasaki attending a conference and making speeches on issues relating to nuclear weapons. And I guess what I'm reminded of at this kind of moment is a line from a famous document called the Russell-Einstein Manifesto that was issued in 1955, shortly before the death of Albert Einstein. And it was a call for global nuclear disarmament, but it had a line in there that I think is very appropriate for this occasion. It's very short. They said, "Remember your humanity, forget the rest." And I think that's certainly a theme that was very effectively articulated in the artistry that we've seen so far today. I must say, however, the emotional symphony that a couple of movements in particular, the ones on bullying, competition, and greed, rang some familiar bells with some meetings I've been in at the UN. The UN, of course, was created on the smoking rubble of World War II. A war, the worst in history, that left 70 million dead. And what most forget is that over half of those deaths were civilians. So what was the purpose of this strange organization that was created after the war? Well, the Charter of the UN lists the following as the most solemn purposes of the Charter. One is to save succeeding generations from the scourge of war. Another is to promote human rights and, quote, the dignity and worth of the human person, unquote. It's also to build the rule of law in the relations between states and to promote social progress and better standards of life. Now, the system that was established after the war, the charter system, offers a unique approach for maintaining international peace and security that involves really three principal strands. And they really reinforce each other and cannot be pursued independently of the other. They all must be done together. These are like the three pillars of the whole system. One is disarmament, a word that appears twice in the UN Charter. Second is regulation of armaments, which is a different concept, which I'll talk about later. And third, certain norms against the use of force. In particular, the two solemn norms of the Charter are the prohibition on the threat or use of force and the positive obligation to solve disputes peacefully, the peaceful resolution of disputes. Over the years, the General Assembly defined disarmament to mean the elimination of what were called, in 1946, incidentally, weapons adaptable to mass destruction, quote unquote. And these were nuclear weapons, chemical weapons, and biological. And they were slated for total elimination because of their inherent indiscriminate nature. The other weapons, conventional arms, states are allowed to retain such weapons to maintain their borders, to solve their national defense needs and other purposes, also to meet international peacekeeping operations. There is a distinction then between eliminating certain weapons and merely limiting or regulating them. And we maintain that distinction. Our job at the UN is not to limit or regulate nuclear weapons. We are trying to get rid of them globally. Now, many of you have heard the UN blamed for things. Oh, well, the UN didn't do this. The UN failed to solve that problem. The UN is a gathering of states. They come together. It's the states who make the decisions. They approve our budget. They determine what our priorities are. They determine what what gets done and what doesn't get done. So in a way, blaming the UN for not solving these problems is a little like blaming a thermometer for hot weather. The UN is telling you something about the level of agreement there exists among states on certain issues. When there is agreement, we can do wonderful, great things. When there is not, it becomes a lot more difficult. And frankly, we have to rely on the bully pulpit, our speeches and statements, our exhortation, largely through the words and voices of our leaders of our organization, particularly the Secretary General. I'm very pleased that all of us UN Secretary Generals have supported disarmament very strongly, and I'm delighted that our current Secretary General, Ban Ki-moon, has been by far more active than any of his predecessors in pushing this issue. He has launched a 5-point nuclear disarmament proposal that has gained the support of over 140 countries now, including organizations such as the Interparliamentary Union of all the world's parliaments. He has traveled personally and was the first time of any Secretary General to visit Hiroshima and Nagasaki and made a speech at the Hiroshima Peace Memorial Ceremony. He personally visited the Semipalatinsk nuclear test site in Kazakhstan, which is troubled with all kinds of environmental nightmares right now due to all the nuclear testing that went on there. He visited Chernobyl. It's quite interesting. Even Dag Hammarskjöld, 50 years ago, was called disarmament a hardy perennial at the UN. So in a sense, we rely very much on the Secretary General to speak not to individual states, but to speak to the global interest, interests that transcend borders. And that's largely what I've been doing in working in the Office for Disarmament Affairs, in working to promote this on a global level, this progress in disarmament. Now, since the focus of this meeting is on the role of the arts, and since I have a little bit of a bias on this, since I am a trumpet player in the UN Symphony Orchestra, I feel like I'm committed that I have to, and I'm delighted to do this, but some of you might be a little curious as to how someone gets into a job like this. And frankly, I was very much influenced by the arts at a very young age. I remember very much reading novels like Failsafe, On the Beach, seeing films like 7 Days in May, Dr. Strangelove, and also dramatic reenactments of the Cuban Missile Crisis. I was in fifth grade or sixth grade during the Cuban Missile Crisis in Washington, Northern Virginia, and I remember the air raid sirens and huddling under desks and crouching over in hallways, and those are can't but have a formative influence on your thinking about these issues. So I went to Princeton, I got a PhD in political science, and I did a study of the development of how the inconceivable could have happened that the United States and the United Kingdom could jointly have developed a particular nuclear reactor called a breeder, which is one of the most dangerous on Earth, costly, inefficient, ineffective, and a terrorist threat, a proliferation threat, complete negatives. They proceeded to build this thing for 30 years each, spent enormous sums of money, and then finally cancel it. My job was to explain how this happened, and what I did is a study of how bureaucracies work. That was how I started to get interested in this. My first 6 years after that were working at a nuclear weapon laboratory in California, the Lawrence Livermore Lab, where I was an analyst working on nuclear nonproliferation issues. Incidentally, I was a musician there as well. And then after that, I worked for Senator John Glenn for 12 years in the U.S. Senate as his advisor on nuclear nonproliferation issues. All of those years, I was focusing on stopping the spread of the weapons. When Glenn retired, I came to work at the UN because I wanted to work on the issue of not the spread of the weapons. It made less difference to me whose hands the weapons are on. What was important to me is the weapons themselves, that we're not going to solve this problem by simply trying to build walls to stop the spread of weapons to other countries. They will get them anyway. We have to delegitimize the weapons themselves, and I felt the best place to do that, the best vantage point, was here at the UN. Now, I'm going to talk to you about the creative ways that the arts have helped us in promoting this agenda. I won't talk about the destructive arts, because there is another opportunity for another meeting I think we could equally devote to the destructive arts, the arts that promote the culture of violence, the arts that promote, as seen, for example, in our films and television programs and video games and sometimes in music. That's a subject for another day. I'd like to talk about more of the how the creative arts can have been used. And also in particular, why it is that the UN has focused so much, almost myopically it seems, on nuclear weapons when there's all these other challenges that remain. Well, there's a remarkable analysis done by a professor at Washington, University of Washington. His name is Paul Bryans, and he's not a strategic analyst. He's a professor of English. And he wrote a book called Nuclear Holocausts, Atomic War in Fiction. I think you might be interested in the subheading. 1895 to 1984. Uh-huh. 1895. Well, it turns out that there was a book written by an Irish journalist named Robert Cromie called Crack of Doom that was published in 1895 that dealt with nuclear explosions. Listen to what he had to say to describe these explosions. 1895. Then the sea behind us burst into a flame, followed by the sound of an explosion so frightful that we were almost stunned by it. A huge mass of water, torn up in a solid block, was hurled into the air, and there it broke into 100 roaring cataracts. These, in the brilliant searchlight from the ship, which were now turned upon them in full, fell like cataracts of liquid silver into the seething cauldron of water that raged below. Well, some of you might have heard of H.G. Wells and a book he published in 1913 called A World Set Free. And here the phrase atomic bomb appeared. And a war was described involving the use of these bombs. That was published, again, on the eve of World War I. Now, if you consult Paul Bryans' work, you'll find that his bibliography has got about 1,000 footnote references to all kinds of short stories, novels, books, films, plays, and the like. And the book also includes a brief synopsis of each of these. And it's really quite fascinating to see how novelists have treated this issue in terms of how these wars happen and what their tragic effects are on humanity. There's also some really terrific dramas that have been done on these themes. I've seen two recently, A Walk in the Woods, which is A Walk in the Woods and Reykjavik are both plays dealing with negotiations that take place on nuclear weapons issues. And there's also a marvelous play by Michael Frayn called Copenhagen, which is about a dialogue between Niels Bohr and Werner Heisenberg about nuclear physics in just before the end of World War II. The UN's own history of promoting disarmament through the arts has relied a lot on its publications, on its role as a forum for holding meetings and symposia, for inviting musicians to come in and artists. And indeed, I would just want to underscore that this is, after all, one of the oldest goals of the United Nations. You go back to January 24, 1946, when the General Assembly adopted its first resolution. And the goal of that first resolution was identified as the elimination of nuclear atomic weapons and other weapons adaptable to mass destruction. So we've been pursuing this. I would argue that it is our oldest goal at the UN. And since then, it's been enlarged to cover nuclear, chemical, biological weapons, and also small arms and conventional arms. We rely a lot on public education, on brochures, posters, annual. We have a disarmament yearbook that comes out. We have an excellent website, which I strongly recommend to all who have an interest in further learning about this. We draft op-eds and publish papers at conferences. We have enormous outreach to the public. We have enormous contacts with civil society groups. And all of the point of all of this effort is to mobilize political will, is to strengthen political support and diversify it among ever different types of groups in society, not just the peace and disarmament groups, but also women's groups, environmentalists, human rights groups, doctors. You know, one of the most active initiatives right now is from mayors. Can you believe mayors would have an interest in nuclear weapon issues? There's an organization called Mayors for Peace that now has over 5,400 city representatives from all around the world, representing a combined population of over a billion people. Why mayors? Well, think about it. If nuclear weapons are used, who will be the first responders? Where will they likely be used? They'll likely be used on cities if they're used. Who will have to put out the fires? Who will have to bury the dead, care for the injured? It's the cities that will bear the burden of this, so it is not at all surprising that mayors would take an interest in it. And we've also been pleased that parliamentarians have as well. Now, we have to sometimes resort to some creative measures in order to communicate our issues. Like, one of my favorite, for example, is a statistic of how much money has been spent on nuclear weapons. A study done by the Brookings Institution in 1999, over a decade ago, said that the total expense for just the United States alone on nuclear weapons is $5.6 trillion. And to illustrate that visually, they said, imagine a stack of dollar bills containing $5.6 trillion. If you take $1 and put it down on this stage, put another one on top, and you keep doing that for $5.6 trillion, that stack goes to the moon and almost all the way back to Earth again. I've since contacted the analyst that drafted that statistic, and I said, that's as of 1999. Where does that stack go now? And also, where does it go covering all the other countries that are spending money on nuclear weapons? And he said, oh yes, it comes back down to Earth again and goes around the equator several times. All right, that's one way to communicate the size. Another way, we get petitions in all the time from all around the world on nuclear weapon issues. One year we got a 1 million signatures that came in from an initiative called CANT, C-A-N-T, Cities Are Not Targets. Now, we have a little office, a real small office, by the way. It's one of the smallest in the UN. The UN spends more on cleaning services than they do on disarmament. Let's put everything into perspective here. You know what our priorities are. What do you do with a million boxes containing a million signatures? Well, what we did is we developed our own twin towers. We have Lucite stacks that go in our disarmament display in the visitors lobby, in the visitors center of the UN. A stack going from floor to ceiling of a Lucite container containing the signatures of all of these people there. And then we also left a signature book right next to it, which we originally intended there only as a display, as an illustration of how the signatures were gathered. Well, guess what's happened? Everyone who comes into the visitors' lobby and goes through there has been signing that book. We can't keep up replacing that book because there's so many signatures involved. So it's really, there's enormous support in the world for this, and we're doing the best we can to promote it in any way we can very cleverly. Many of you have visited the UN, if you just walk around the grounds of the UN, you'll find many disarmament all around you, disarmament and peace. You'll find the famous twisted gun statue, which is a revolver with a barrel tied in a knot. That was donated by a statue donated by Luxembourg. You'll find the swords and the plowshares statue donated in the late 50s by the USSR, which has a man wielding a huge hammer, pounding a sword into a plow device. You'll see the Ralph Bunche steps, which has the quote from the Bible, from Isaiah, about beating swords into plowshares. You'll see the St. George and the Dragon statue, which is called Good Defeats Evil, which was submitted by a Russian sculptor. And it has St. George on a horse with a spear going into a dragon on the ground. And the dragon is made out of parts of SS-20 missiles and Pershing missiles, that intermediate range nuclear force missiles that were dismantled in 1987. You'll see the Chagall stained glass mural we have devoted to the struggle for peace. And you'll find a very unusual statue by a British sculptress named Barbara Hepworth, which is a blob of steel that's pitted all over with dents. And in the middle of it is this perfect circle. And this was put here by the request of Hammarskjöld. And it really is a very effective demonstration of the work we do with the UN. We have all these little activities that go on. They don't, each individual poke at that problem doesn't solve the problem, but it advances it. And it gets to the point where you eventually find some, at the very moment when you solve the problem, when you get a consensus, when you have a vote and everyone agrees, when you really do serve a global public good, then you found that circle in that hole. And it's a very moving metaphor. And it's interesting that every day when the Secretariat walks to work, you have to walk by that statue. So I've thought a lot about that. Since 2002, we have had a disarmament and nonproliferation education initiative. We had a group of governmental experts that did a study for us on how to develop a curricula for teachers to use at the elementary, high school, college, and postgraduate levels, to how to teach them to promote peaceful resolution of disputes and to understand how disarmament can happen. We have had several recent contests that we're very proud of. We've had a devoted to young people, teenagers in particular. We had a Poetry for Peace contest that was a social media effort that we did over the web. We received over 700 poems, and the people who were submitting the poems were invited to listen to some testimonies by the survivors at Hiroshima, and then to write a poem based on what they understand as a result of these testimonies. More recently this year, we had an Art for Peace contest, which was very successful. We had children from 92 countries submitting over 6,600 paintings on to envision a world without nuclear weapons. We had three age groups, 5 to 8, 9 to 12, and 13 to 17, and we had four winners in each of these age group categories. And I'm very proud that we have now converted that into a calendar, which we have in the UN gift shop, and I'm going to be very pleased to donate this to the school, and I hope that it'll inspire people to do their own paintings. Lastly, I'd like to mention that we also believe that the acting profession is very helpful to us in the field of disarmament, because they, if any of you have ever heard a professional actor make a speech, they know how to persuade an audience. They just have that gift. Ronald Reagan had that gift. Well, the UN has a group of people called messengers of peace, that people like Angelina Jolie, for example, and others who have been called to speak on important global issues. Well, our messenger for peace is Michael Douglas, and he has traveled all around the world making speeches, focusing largely on small arms issues because of the horrible effect that they have, especially in developing countries. And he's been really a terrific, effective voice. And that is another role for the arts, I think. We have a brand new initiative that we're just launching now, as a matter of fact. It's scheduled to go from 2013 to 2014. And I think it's very germane to this nightmare that we just lived through at Sandy Hook. It's called Peace, Not Violence. It's a global teaching and learning project to promote a culture of nonviolence and peace. Did you know that last year, 740,000 people died as a result of armed violence? Now, of those, most of these occurred in countries that are not involved in armed conflicts. This is an amazing statistic. It's from the Geneva Declaration on Armed Violence, which has their own website on this. It's a really terrific site. One of the greatest irritants of this problem is the illicit trade in small arms and light weapons. At the UN, starting in 2002, we had an international agreement called the Program of Action on Small Arms, designed to curb the illicit trafficking in these weapons. We have initiatives to provide for the marking and tracing of weapons so that if they are being sent to regions of conflict or in violation of Security Council arms embargoes, we will know where they came from, we meaning the states. And also there's new controls against brokering or intermediaries involving the transshipment of these weapons. These are just some of the things that we're working on. This Peace Not Violence initiative, by the way, will involve testimonies by victims of armed violence to enable school children to talk to these victims about their experiences and also to hear from reformed perpetrators, people who have been involved in perpetrating these horrible acts, who have received treatment and have turn their lives around and can come and give their own testimony about how they've been able to turn to recover from this and to move on. And it's really, I think, a very important initiative, and especially in light of what's been happening in around our country here. This has been a brief introduction to what the UN has been doing. I'm sorry I spoke so long. There is a lot more I could address about what we're doing in the field of poverty reduction and environmental issues, peacekeeping, peace building after civil conflicts that also are germane to what we're talking about here. I would like to conclude also by once again suggesting that if any of you have any further interest in this, our website is at the un.org/disarmament, and virtually anything you'll need, I think, will be there. Once again, I want to thank you all for coming to this event. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for selecting such a great topic for your meeting today. Thank you.
Art for peace. Thank you so much, Randy. It's so good to really understand how much money is going into war, weapons. It's shocking. So let's make art, not war, as we're doing right now. So spread the word. Okay, our final presentation for today is the Peace Dance Trilogy. It is choreographed by one of our faculty members, Nancy Koprek, and the students from Transforming Community Through the Arts. The piece begins by mocking the politicians, the, quote, masters of war, who make the decisions which lead to war. The scene changes to the soldiers who fight the war and the innocent civilians who are killed. The second part of the trilogy, One Tribe, shows the alternative to war. The soldiers come home relieved that they no longer have to kill to stay alive. They rejoice in the fact that they are indeed one people. The last movement takes place with the 1 Million March for Peace, held here in New York City in the background. Holly Near sings while the people gather to sing for peace.
What? What is this? What? The fools, the mad fools. What's happened?
The doomsday machine.
The doomsday machine? What is that?
A device which will destroy all human and animal life on Earth.
All human and animal life?
Come, you masters of war. You're to build a big gun. Build a plane, is it build a big bomb? Is it hide behind walls? Is it hide behind this? I just want you to know I can see through your mind. You're the never done, but built to destroy. Play with my world like it's your little toy. You put a gun in my hand and you hide from my eyes. Then you turn and run farther when the phantom bullet flies like Judas Rose. Be one you want me to believe. I see through your eyes, I see through your brain. trigger for the others to fire. Then you sit back and watch while the death count gets higher. You hide in your mansion while your people's blood flows out of their bodies and is drowned in the mud. Is your money that good? Will it buy you forgiveness? Do you think that it could? Well, I think you will find when your death tank's in stone. Ah, the money you pay won't find back die, and your death will come soon. I'll follow your casket by the pale afternoon, and I'll watch while you're lower, bound to your deathbed, and I'll stand over your grave till I'm sure that you're dead.
One people,
one tribe.
tribe, one tribe, one tribe, one time, one planet, one race, one love, one people, one. Too many things that's causing one to forget about the main cause. Connect and uniting, but the evil is seated and alive in us. So our weapons are colliding, and our peace is seeking like Poseidon. But we know that the one, the evil one's planned by the sun. So we come and try to separate the sun, but he dumb. He didn't know we had a will to overcome. Rejuvenate by the beat of the drum. Come together by the cycle of the hum. With freedom when all become one. Forever, one tribe, y'all. One tribe, y'all. One heart, one beat, we equal. Connected like the internet, united, that's how we do. Let's break one soul we see through. Let love and peace lead you. We can overcome the complication, cause we need to. Help each other make these changes. Brother, sister, rearrange this way of thinking, that we can change this bad condition. Break. Use your mind and not your greed. Let's connect and then proceed. This is something I believe. We are one, we're all just people. One tribe, y'all. One tribe, y'all. One tribe, y'all. We are one people. Let's get amnesia. Forget about all that. Let's catch amnesia. Let's catch amnesia. Forget about all that evil that they feed ya. One tribe, y'all. One tribe, y'all. One people. One people. One people. One people. One people. One people. Let's catch amnesia. Lord, help me out. Trying to figure out what it's all about.
What it's all about.
Cause we're one and the same.
One and the same.
Same joy, same pain. And I hope that you're there when I need ya. Cause maybe we need amnesia. And I don't wanna sound like a preacher, but we need to be one. One world, one love, one passion. One tribe, one understanding. Cause you and me can become one. One.
Yeah.
Okay, wow. That was amazing. We have a section now where you can participate with questions or things, insights that you've had watching the different presentations. And you two have things that you want the group to do, right? Okay, but before you do, I would also like to welcome a very special guest here who has brought his paintings to the new school that are anti-war paintings, and they're at the Lang Cafe. So when we have our reception, Broderick Price will be there, and he will be answering any questions about his work and also anything that you want to share with him. So if you can stand up and let everybody know who you are. Broderick, thank you. Thank you for sharing your wonderful paintings with us. It's made this whole performance complete.
Hi. So inside all of your programs, you have little note cards. Some of them have...
What's your mic on?
They control it up there.
If it's green, it's on.
It's red.
Turn the mute on.
Hello?
Thank you. Anyway, so you all have note cards in your program. Some of you have more than one, just in case, you know, you want to read more than one. But so we created these just sort of, they were kind of the inspiration, at least for me, really helped me get into the purpose of this dance. Some of them are quotes about peace, about war. Some of them are images, etc. So a few of us are going to share some of our favorite quotes, and then we thought we would open it up to the audience if anybody is inspired either by what you read or what you saw and you would just like to say something or ask a question. We would love that. Sort of the point of this evening is not that it ends with this. This is actually the very beginning, and that it takes all of us to make this difference going forward. So. My favorite quote that I found while working on this project is by John Greenleaf Whittier, and it's, "Peace hath higher tests of man than battle ever knew."
Mine is, "Reach out to those you fear, touch the heart of complexity, imagine beyond what is seen, risk vulnerability one step at a time, and don't just think outside the box, be willing to take the risk to live outside the box." This is from The Moral Imagination by John Paul Lederach.
Mine is, "You can no more win a war than you can win an earthquake."
Who said that?
Jeanette Rankin.
And I choose one really simple, that a piece starts with a smile. So sometimes you think about it and you want to do something really big, but you just need to start and smile and it will sparkle everything. And it's from Mother Teresa.
Yeah, me too. I'm sorry that I had the same thing to share with you, but I would elaborate a bit on that because I'm very much connected to the United Nations. I have been working there for like over 20 years. So therefore, my main thing, I cannot go out to the world to talk about nuclear war, whatever, but just a pretty smile and then making the other person know that you are very important. You are really important, you're an important person. That was a real thing, and you, but when you say good morning, that I give a message to them. So that is what it is, that is peace.
So are there any of the quotes that you have that inspire you, that you'd like to share, or any of your own thoughts?
Questions?
It's always hard to be the first. Here we have a winner.
I like the quote that you put in my program, so thank you. I'll read it to you.
You need a mic. You need a mic.
Mary's on her way.
All right.
Okay, thank you to everyone, Louise, all the performers. It was wonderful. This is a quote that you put in the program, thank you, by Nelson Mandela. It says, "If you want to make peace with your enemy, you have to work with your enemy. Then he becomes your partner." It was a very profound quote.
I'll take it.
This is the quote in my card. It says,
Peace is not an absence of war. It is a virtue, a state of mind, a disposition for benevolence, confidence, justice, by Spinoza, Brooks Spinoza. And I just wanted to thank everyone also. I really didn't know what to expect. I just came with my sister. And what I'm taking from this performance is that even though the world suffers from a tremendous involvement in war and violence, if everybody's just a force for light and peace, maybe we can have nonviolence.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else like to say anything or share what they have on their card?
Yes.
Hello, I'd like to share a biblical verse. Love thy neighbor as you love thyself. This is quoted from Jesus Christ, the Messiah.
This is a nice one. Better than 1,000 hollow words is one word that brings peace. The Buddha.
Peace cannot be kept by force. It can only be achieved by understanding. Albert Einstein.
Back here.
A fence is not erected if all is well. A proverb of Kenya.
This is a quote from The Moral Imagination by John Paul Lederach. Find a way to meet the human.
All right, anybody else want to share?
This is an African proverb. Until lions have their historians, tales of the hunt shall always glorify the hunter.
All right, thank you for everyone who shared.
Thank you so much.
Everyone who didn't, we hope it inspires you.
Now, if you look on the back of the card, there's actually a list of different organizations and projects that you can get involved in, such as International Crisis Group, SGI USA, Love, Leave Out Violence. There's also a very interesting one called Citizen Effect, and it's actually a website that you can go on, and you can search different projects based on your interests. So if you're interested in anti-war projects or anything, you can put anything that you're interested in, and it will search different projects that you might be interested in getting involved in. CATW, Coalition Against Trafficking Women. Of women.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any others that you know of that you would like to share as well that are not on this list?
And of course the UN, as Randy mentioned before.
And also one of the other projects that was seen tonight, this Polaris group, there's Make the Road. I'm sorry if I'm leaving. What am I leaving out?
There's Give Music Kids, which is another one of our class projects for transforming the community through the arts.
So we hope that as you leave today, that these quotes and the facts on your cards inspire something inside of you, and you can either share that with someone else or get involved or, keep it to yourself. We just hope that we have sparked something for you. So. As we depart, we hope that we see you at the reception to follow again in the Lane Cafe. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.